Thanks, everybody. And I stand as the Managing Director of Abacus Group, which, for those of you who've been around, will realize Abacus has been on the stock exchange since the early 2000s. But we were very happy, and with the assistance of the ASX in August last year, we undertook a de-staple of the Abacus Group to create two listed companies that I'll touch on today. One is the group, which basically consists of our commercial office, retail, and a slice of our storage business. And the second one is Abacus Storage King, which is a pure-play self-storage REIT that we de-stapled with the 3 billion dollars worth of investments in self-storage, predominantly properties, trading properties, some development assets, as well as the company, the operating platform called Storage King, which has existed in the Australian market and New Zealand market since 1996 and is a very well-recognized brand. I think if I move this. So just to give you a bit of a summary, the two businesses are reasonably similar size, about 3 billion dollars worth of assets. And the group has, as I said, existed for a long period of time. But what we've been able to do in the last 5 or 6 years is curate the investment portfolio to be predominantly Eastern Seaboard, Brisbane, Sydney, and Melbourne. Most of the exposure is actually in New South Wales. And also assets that we believe have a particular place, competitive place in the market, and are attractive to their tenant occupants. The business is diversified across office. We do have a small exposure to retail, being predominantly the Oasis Shopping Centre on the Gold Coast, which is a very vibrant mixed-use development on the Gold Coast. Plus, we own a third of the Myer Melbourne store, CBD store down in the CBD of Melbourne. As I said, we retained an interest, nearly 20% interest in the Storage King business because we have owned Storage King properties since back in 2005. And you can see they're diversified down the Eastern Seaboard, a combination of CBD buildings in Brisbane, Sydney, and Melbourne, as well as a couple of fringe buildings, fringe being markets that are sort of within a 5K radius of the CBDs, predominantly Sydney and in Melbourne. Conservatively geared, 30% geared, strong balance sheet. We've been able to reset the debt facilities. We've termed out our debt facilities and hedged that debt such that we have enormous capacity on the balance sheet today to not only invest into our existing buildings, but also to undertake any acquisitions if we deem them appropriate. Some of the buildings, you might recognize some of these buildings. This is almost 60% of our portfolio. We own a single building in North Sydney, 99 Walker Street, which is where the Coles supermarket is in the basement. We moved recently our headquarters into our building we purchased above Westfield, Sydney, 77 Castlereagh Street. It's actually been around for a long time, that building, but was incorporated beautifully within the Westfield, Sydney Shopping Centre complex. So we have 11 office levels above Westfield. We do own a piece, 32% of the building on the corner of Park, Castlereagh, and Elizabeth Street in Sydney. We own 32% of that building with Charter Hall. As I mentioned, Oasis Shopping Centre, very vibrant, mixed-use facility, combination of car parks, restaurants, office building, office tenants upstairs, as well as a very strong trading supermarket and retail floor, ground floor. And then the building on the corner of Creek and Queen Street up in Brisbane, 324 Queen Street, the old ANZ complex. We've owned that for quite a time. Each of the buildings have their place in the market. They aren't the most shiny, and they're certainly not the most expensive rent buildings in the market. And we think in this market, particularly since COVID, that's actually a competitive point of difference. We have a very strong thesis that for buildings to maintain their relevance in this market post-COVID, you have to have a combination of physical location, connection to public transport, quality of amenity, end-of-trip facilities, look and feel of the lobbies, public spaces, plus a rent level that is affordable. And each of these buildings certainly fit that mold. If I turn to the storage business, this is a business we're very excited about. It's in a growth strategy. We've increased our investment in self-storage from nearly $600 million back in 2017 to just over $3.1 billion. And why are we excited about it? Because we think that the self-storage industry in Australia is certainly at the very early stages of an upswing. We're about a third of the penetration of the UK and the US market in self-storage. And as well, we think that with the evolution of the product, you can see there a slightly skewed image of one of our new storage facilities. You are seeing storage buildings now that are light years better and better equipped, better located than self-storage would have been 10, maybe up to 20 years ago. See if I can take this back. So what we have today is a portfolio of investments, about 120 trading stores across the country, a lot in New South Wales, very strong penetration and market positioning here in New South Wales, which is where Storage King, the operating platform, originated from. We do have a lot of investments over in New Zealand, predominantly in Auckland. And what we've been able to do in the last 5 or 6 years is deliver on developments of brand new storage facilities. So these are storage facilities that tend to be in suburban, inner urban locations. They're where the people live. We pick locations depending on demographics, on level of income, on the type of dwellings that exist in those markets. And we build stores, as you see from that image, multi-level stores, well located, easily accessible, lots of technology. Occasionally we do use facial recognition, but certainly have pin pad accessibility, in some cases 24/7 accessible. And people are voting with their feet effectively. So what we see is that as we build stores in bigger, stronger, better locations, people are using these storage units as an adjunct to their everyday life, be it their home, they want an extension of their home, or they need space for their buildings or their businesses or their trades to store product. So you can see here the investments that we own across the chart there is an established portfolio of stores that we've owned, some of them up to almost 20 years. You then have acquisitions that we've acquired in the last few years. Stabilizing, you'll see the occupancy of those stabilizing stores at 57%. They're buildings that we've either completed or have recently completed developments and they're in lease-up mode. And then we've got a number of development sites. Almost 10% of the balance sheet is blocks of land or buildings that we will redevelop or develop from scratch to create these style of brand new format contemporary storage facilities. The rent levels are quite manageable. What we're seeing is that as people experience storage and COVID, as it turned out from June 2020 to June 2022, in Australia and in most markets of the world, self-storage had the best operating markets and conditions ever experienced. And what we think happened is that a lot of people experienced self-storage, tried it, had a good experience, and have actually stayed on since. So whilst we saw double-digit growth back through that 20 to 22 period, we've actually been able to retain quite strong growth levels since that period. And also we've seen strong acceptance in local markets for this new format, contemporary style storage facility, which does give us the confidence to keep investing in and building brand new stores. So the platform as we have established it, as of the de-staple, strong asset backing, pretty conservative cap rate and valuation metrics, 29% geared, acquisition capacity, debt facilities, plus also we have a stake in another listed company that we're able to sell if we deem appropriate. And that gives us capacity of almost $400 million to invest into acquisitions of stores or to complete the developments that we're undertaking. And we have a number of major projects underway at the moment. Our two biggest projects are happening here in Sydney, one at Mascot out near the airport, almost 10,000 metres of lettable area in storage, a 10-level facility we'll build in Mascot. And the second one will be our biggest project at Lidcombe, just near Homebush on Carter Street. We'll build nearly 11,000 square metres of lettable area. And one of the major imperatives that we see in our projects, as you can see from the scale of the buildings, if we locate them in strong, suburban, highly dense infill locations, you can create the buildings to be effectively billboards for the product. So when you drive from Brisbane Airport north on the freeway, you'll see an enormous Storage King facility on the freeway. When we complete the project at Homebush, you'll see three or four levels of Storage King as a billboard for the product. As I said, Storage King as a brand has been in the Australian market for nearly 25 years. And the industry association tells us it's the most recognised brand in the market. There are two or three other major national brands, National Storage from Brisbane, a listed company, the only other self-storage listed company in Australia, and Kennard Self-Storage, which is a privately owned business owned by a family based here in Sydney. Other than that, Storage King is the only other national major brand, and our industry association tells us is the most recognised brand in the Australian and New Zealand marketplace. So we're very excited about the prospects. We have set the business. It's only been on the stock exchange now just over 8 months. These results were the first results as an isolated self-storage company. We're very pleased with the results. You'll see their 90% occupancy for the portfolio actually sits almost globally at best practice, delivering well in excess of inflation type rent growth with 90% occupancy is a very strong performance for any self-storage business. So it does have a lot of tailwinds. We think that population growth, density of population, people moving interstate, the rise of e-commerce, people using online deliveries more and more. There isn't a last mile logistics element to self-storage, and about 30% of our customers, we believe, are not domestic storers, they're business storers. So we think that all the tailwinds combined with an evolution of the product that we are building and delivering and installing in the suburban areas means that there is a strong trajectory of growth possible for this asset class, and the business is well placed to take advantage of that. We do have, as I said, some investments in New Zealand. They're typically stable assets in New Zealand that we've owned for some time. And the brand itself is, again, quite a dominant brand over in New Zealand. And as I said, the business is managed. It's an externally managed REIT. It is managed by Abacus Group. And Abacus Group retains a 20%, 19.8% interest in the Storage King REIT because of our long-standing investments dating back to 2005. That really ends the information for the presentation. Happy to take any questions, Ian, if you think there's any.
Stephen, I can tell you, there are questions. The audience has done very good on the way through your presentation. It's very interesting to hear you talk about de-stapling, because 20 years ago, the go was stapling, so you've actually split two companies and listed them separately. A number of questions coming in from our audience. They're just changing as I start to read. What are the major differences between the ASK portfolio and National Storage's portfolio?
So what we understand from the public available information is that the proportion of our assets in country and regional locations is between 10 and 20%. From what we understand in the National Storage portfolio, they have a higher proportion of country and regional locations. And we are targeted in our investments. I think if I can go back to the presentation, we have mapped the country for where we have a discipline as to where we will invest and want to install facilities. We have a strong belief that putting storage in suburban, in urban locations drives a better economic return, and we strongly adhere to that. That does shape where we buy and where we build. And that has ended up with a portfolio with a bigger skew to suburban.
Would you like us to try and find that slide?
No, that's okay. It was just a map that showed you where predominantly in New South Wales. But
back to the question I was about to ask. What is your take on the future of storage solutions in terms of innovation and adding to the customer proposition?
I think there's been a cultural awareness of self-storage, and people are more and more realising that for a small dollar value, it's easily accessible. And it becomes a big convenience, whether it be for a domestic storer adjacent to a home, wanting to extend a home. Some people hide cars or jet skis or golf clubs or any manner of stuff in storage. But we also believe, as I said, that last mile logistics element in strong infill suburban locations, businesses find it very useful to have storage facilities available to them. So when we build a facility, it's often designed appropriate for the local market, and we can design whether they're big units easily driven to or whether they're on the upper levels, you walk down a corridor, we certainly tailor make it for the market that exists in the catchment area.
Right, something close to my heart, wine. Do you offer wine storage?
We do in selected locations. We've found over the years, and Storage King for over 25 years have found that actually keeping it pretty simple, the value proposition, and the simplicity of it is what space do you need? Do you need 1 cubic metre? Do you need 10 cubic metres? Do you need an entire garage? That's about the level of complexity that
we go to. I'm the 1 cubic metre guy.
And we're happy with that.
This is not an unexpected one, I would imagine. Can you comment on the outlook for working from home and the hybrid trends and how they may impact your business?
Sure, and I think that certainly is a factor, and it's a factor in predominantly bigger scale office buildings. We found at the onset of COVID, our portfolio, we only have about 320 tenants in our whole portfolio. And we found that people were using the office. They like the office, they need the office. And I think that's certainly a case in small to medium-sized enterprises. I think what you're seeing as work starts to evolve, as the economy faces some pressures, businesses are right-sizing how much space they need. We are seeing some tenants that are expanding in their space. Some tenants are contracting in their space. We have very few, in fact, I could almost count them on one hand, a number of multi-floor tenants in our portfolio. And I think that does position us a bit differently to some of the other premium grade office owners.
There's a question here around NTA and discounts, which I think is typical of the industry at the moment. Often used to trade going back through the years at premiums. What have you got in store to actually perhaps address those issues?
Yeah, so it has been a factor. And I think since the de-staple, pulling the business into two halves, we found that we became a smaller group, and smaller doesn't necessarily mean more attention. So index inclusion, we moved from the 200 index to the ASX 300 index. But also we have a major investor. We've had a major investor in the Abacus Group, now in both groups since 2010. And that individual owns 50% of Abacus Group and 40% of Abacus Storage King. So the liquidity of the enterprise is lower. We actually see that as a big positive in the current market conditions. And you know, we're working hard to invest our capital where best we see medium to long-term growth opportunities, income growth opportunities. And because we're an owner of office buildings, for example, we're not motivated to grow to be the biggest in the market. We're motivated to provide the best earnings growth, which obviously flows through to dividends growth for investors.
Interesting one here around climate change, climate-related and financial disclosures. What steps has the company taken in this regard to prepare?
Yeah, so the commercial buildings are obviously managed a lot according to NABERS ratings on energy and water and waste, and we produce a sustainability report. In the case of self-storage, and we've put a fair bit of this on our website, we do feel, and certainly it's a theme in the US, that self-storage is one of the lightest environmental impact asset classes. We use very little in the way of power. We generate no waste. And we basically don't have a lot of people on site. So we've actually installed a lot of solar. So we're almost a net positive producer of energy, renewable energy. And I think in climate change, you know, one thing that we have taken a lot of focus on, and it comes to this discipline about where it is we want to invest, is that we make sure that we don't invest in areas that are prone to floods and prone to fires and in areas that may or may not be impacted going forward. So it certainly does impact. And I think on the commercial property side, there's certainly a lot of steps that we've taken.
One last one to finish on, Stephen. There's more to come. You mentioned the uplift that you received from COVID in terms of self-storage.
Yes.
Have you seen drop-off in that regard now?
There has been in the last 2 or 3 years, but nowhere near to the degree that we expected. I think we went to, I think we were 15 to 20% income growth for that two-year period. And we're still sitting, you know, between 5 and 10% income growth, which relative to most other asset classes in the commercial space, certainly that's a very attractive proposition.
Great. Good note to finish on. Let's say thank you to Stephen again.
Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Stephen.
Part of
good to see you.
Good to see you again.